Hey everyone, it's Dark Knight Admin, and we're back with more Admin Prep with Data and Analytics Management. In this section, it's all about data. We're talking about how to update data, how to mass delete data, how to export data. We're going to talk about validation tools, we're going to talk about reports, report types. We're going to talk about how to share model affects things on the reports. We're going to talk about dashboards as well. So first, what's a report? In a report, you need to identify the type. So what object or objects are you looking at? What is the time frame? So from when to when? What data do you want to see? So within that object, what are the fields that you want to look at? What's the format that we want to select? Is it going to be tabular versus summary or matrix or join? Do you need any totals? So do you need to do any summation of those values? What are the records that you want? Do you need to add additional criteria? Do you need to add any visual aspects to your report on top of just looking at the basic data? Within Salesforce, there are some default report types. Salesforce comes with a bunch of default reports, and you can see most of them here. If you don't see a report type that you want, you can go ahead and create a custom report type. So basically, you create a custom report type when the standard report types don't do what you need to do. So maybe you need to have some different object configuration. Maybe you need to have different relationships tied between the records, and a standard report doesn't fit that build. You can go to custom report types and build one. Within a custom report type, you can specify the primary object. You always have to specify the primary object. In this scenario, I have the account. You can specify the related object, which I have as contacts. And when you specify the related record, you can specify each A record, so the account must have at least one related B record, or you can specify that, say, the B records may or may not have a relation to A. So in this scenario, I am saying that every contact here has to have an account. So when I pull this report back, it's going to show me all the accounts that have contacts that also have events tied to them. But on the flip side, maybe I don't want it to happen. I want all accounts, and I just want to show the records that also have contacts. So in this scenario, it'll show me all the accounts with contacts, regardless if the account has a contact or not. And they also have the same thing with events. So it's going to show me all the accounts, and then it's going to show me any of the contacts that have, that are tied to those accounts, and then the events that are tied to them as well. When you build a report, you can add some filters. Your first filters are going to be specifying whether or not what you're going to see. So you can add a filter. You can say, show me my accounts, all accounts, the create date, that's your time frame. You can also add additional filters, like the last name starts with something or the mailing state equals something. In addition to having those filters, you can also add additional filter logic, which means I can say I want this filter and this filter to be true, or I can say this one, or I can add additional filters and build really custom logic in there. So if I need to build a really custom report with custom logic, I can utilize my different filters and my filter logic. You may run across a scenario where you need to create what's called a cross filter. Essentially, they're gonna look at the current object and say, show me the contacts with accounts, or show me the contacts without accounts. So you can get that cross filter, and then you can add additional filter logic in there. Another filter that I just want to point out is that show me. These kinds of filters will be shown as the run as user. If the report is my accounts, whoever's running the report will be showing those records. So if I, Jake, am running a report, it's going to show what Jake can see. So if Sue runs a report, it's going to show what Sue will see. So you can use that really to your advantage to build custom reports for everyone in your company if you only want them to see their information. When you're building your report out, you can also add columns, and you can remove or add columns that are relevant to your report. As a tip, you always only want to have the columns on your report that are ideal for your report. You don't want to have extra things in there. It's only going to cause your report to run a little bit longer and could cause your report to fail if you have too many columns in there that aren't needed. Add them by adding the column name here by selecting the name of the field you want. You can close them out here by checking them, click checkbox off that X there. You can also drop and drag them back and forth here. You can also move them across the board here as well if you want to change the order in which the columns are positioned. All right, our first type of report is tabular report. I call these the tubular reports because it's just a bunch of different tubes that are all aligned. So these are your tubes. So there are no groupings. So there are no groupings here. This makes it a tabular report. Basically with this, you can only make lists on your dashboards. You can't do anything else with a tabular report. Next up is the summary report. This allows the initial grouping here. You can group multiple groupings. And this also allows most charts. Essentially, just gonna group your different records here. This one's grouped by account owner. Any of the fields you have on your report, you can group by. You can do up to three groupings in total between here and the column. So you can have three row groups. You can have two row groups and a row group in a column. The next type of report is the matrix report. This is the grouping on the row of columns. So we have our rows here and our columns here. So we can offer more groupings. So we have our column, we have a row groupings up here. We can also add additional columns grouping there. And that's just gonna allow for that matrix chart to develop for you. You can also use most charts with this. The last type of report type is what we call a join report. Essentially, you take two report types and you mash them together, and they're filtered on a same field. So when you build these, you're gonna have to have some relationship between the two different report types. There's going to have to be some type of association. If you don't have any association between the two, they're not going to be related to each other. So in the scenario, you can look at 123 warehouse as an account, but doesn't have any cases to it. I have a bunch of cases here that aren't tied to any accounts. With reports, you can also schedule and export them. Once you hit run as, you hit the little drop down there, you can save as, you can subscribe, you can export. You can also add these to campaigns and dashboards. But to schedule a report, you click the subscribe. You can say what the frequency is, daily, weekly, monthly. Specify which day you want it to fire in. If it's weekly, if it's daily, it's going to fire daily. And monthly, it's going to have you selected which day of the month you want it to fire on. Specify the time and conditions. So you can also add additional conditions to your report. So if you want it to fire when you want it to fire, you can add that in there. You can also say who's going to be subscribing to this report. By default, your name is going to be added. You can also remove yourself in the end. You can also add other recipients to this report. You can also specify who the report's going to be running as. So if it's going to be me, it's going to run the report with whatever I can see. If you specify another person, it's going to be running as whatever that person can see. In the same tab over here, we can export data out. And we click the export, we get this little view over here. You can export the formatted report or the details only. So if you format, it's going to export up that formatted report into Excel. Details only, it's just going to be the whole a list of all the different records, and then you can specify the format. You can do Excel, you can also do CSV. When you build your reports, it's going to ask you what folder you want to put them. Depending on what folder you put them in, is going to depend who can see what report. Not necessarily what they can see when they review the report, but what reports can they see. So within a folder, I can create a folder, and I can then add people to that folder to gain access. I can share my folder, then I can specify who has access, and I can put the name of the person there. I can see who has access already. You can identify the type of access they have. They have view, edit, or manage. View means I can only see the reports in this folder. Edit means I can edit the reports in the folder. Manage means I can see the reports, manage the reports. I can also add users to this folder. So if you only have edit access, it means I can't add users, but I can edit the reports that are in that folder. When you're setting up the users here, you can specify the users. You can go users, roles, you can pick other things as well. So if you want to say everyone with a particular role is going to have access to this folder, you can do that as well. So you don't have to always manage assignment as a one-off with a user. You can use roles as well to assign access to a folder. You may get an opportunity to where you need to add reports to a page layout. So if you're on a record and you want to add a report, you can go into your components, click report chart, grab it, drag it onto your page, like right here, specify a label, the report, if you want to do any additional filtering, and then you can have that report live on your record. With dashboards, you can have your dashboard set up here and you can add components of it. This one has three in there. You can customize your view however you want. I have three columns. You can add additional columns. You can move these around and format however you want. We have our components here. If I want to add a new component, I just click the new component on my dashboard. And then it's going to ask, hey, do you want to add a chart to it? Which chart do you want to select? First, you have to specify the reports. You specify the report that matches the one you want. Then you can specify the chart that's going to be available for that type of report. Remember, those different report types are going to dictate whether or not what options you can see in here. You can go ahead and select that, and you can also check your x-axis and your y-axis. And these can vary depending on the report type. So a lot of times, record count is always going to be your x-axis. If you set up a matrix, you can probably change your x-axis report as well. With dashboards, you can make them dynamic. Do you want to use this when you want to specify who the dashboard should be running as? If you select the bureau, it will be the person who ran the report and will be what they can see. So if I specify as me, it's going to be running as me. If I specify as another person, the dashboard is going to run as that person. If I specify the dashboard viewer, it's going to be whatever they can see. So if I select this as an option and I run the dashboard, whatever I see is what I'm going to see. If the dashboard is all about opportunities and I as a user don't have access to opportunities, but I have access to the dashboard, I can run the dashboard, but I won't see anything on the dashboard because I don't have access to any of the records. On your dashboard, you can also create filters. Just a little note that only works with like reports that share the same field. A little side note, if you want to customize the color coordination of all the reports on your dashboard and you want them all to be the same, you can customize a pick list field. So if you have a bunch of reports that are based on the same pick list field, you can pick the color that you want for each of the values in your pick list field. And then on the dashboard, all the values will be the same color. Before we move into the next section, please like, share, and subscribe. I do produce Salesforce tips every week. Data quality. So what makes bad data? Missing records, duplication of records, no standards in your missing data, stale and old data. These are all things that are going to make your CRM fail. And it's going to really impact you with potential lost revenue, waste of time. There's going to be inefficiencies, poor customer service. You don't want when your customers call up and ask you a question, you have them in three different times and you have it logged in one case and not another case. You pulled the wrong record and you have no history of them. Also, decrease user adoption. If users feel they can't trust the data, they're not going to use the data. So you're not going to have them in the system utilizing everything that's in there. A couple of the ways we can make our data better. We can make fields required on creation. So when you create a new field, you can specify that it's required. Basically states that every time you create this record, this field has to be populated. You can create some validation rules. So if you ever want to create a lead, you want to make sure you have a way to contact the lead. Maybe you create a validation rule that says if the email and the phone number are both blank, throw an error saying that they have to populate one of those so that you have a way to contact that lead. You can use automation as well to update things depending on the criteria of values. Your page layout, you can make things read-only and required only. Making fields required on a page layout makes them fill out that value on that. You can also use reports and dashboards, so you can run some reports and dashboards to see what's missing. You can use data enrichment tools, information from another system to update your accounts, contacts, that type of deal. You can use duplication management, so you can use the dedupe rules within Salesforce to find duplicate records. And you can use custom fields. Maybe say, hey, well, that's maybe counterproductive, but you don't want to have the same field. It has different types of data in there all across the board. Create custom fields for the proper things to store the data where it needs to be stored. Some data terms that you're going to run across, there's the insert, which if you use insert, that's going to make new records. If you use update, it's going to update existing records. If you use upsert, this is where you use an external ID and it can update records or make new records. Delete, just like it sounds, can remove records based on the Salesforce ID. Export just exports the data. It does not include deleted data. Export all exports all data, even deleted records that are in your cycling bin. Just a reminder, this is only one object at a time. So when you're using data loader, it's only gonna process the data one object at a time. There are some special fields that typically can never be modified, which are create date, last modified date, creator date, and last modified user. When you load data, you can set some of these fields. So you can set the create date and the record creator if you give yourself the system audit access. Some other data loader practices that you probably want to keep in mind. If you're going to be creating records and you're going to be updating values of fields, make the fields prior to the import. Clean up your data. Use the ID fields, Salesforce IDs, external IDs. Use them when you need to, especially if you're doing migrations. Run sample data loads if you're going to be importing a million records. Run 100 first to see how everything turns out. Run 10. That way you don't waste a lot of time processing things if you miss something or you mismap something. Typically, you don't want to update records during normal business hours. Turn off automation before importing, updating, or upsetting unless you want that to actual fire. And before updating records, back up the data before updating. A little note, if you have an idea for another system, like an accounting system, you can make a custom text field and Salesforce and make that an external ID. This allows you to use that as your key to upsert data. That way it will update the old records and that it matches to make a new record for ones that don't match. Unique ID only allows a record to be created once, but the value in the field, that text value, can only be both external and unique. So if you make it external ID and unique, it's going to be completely unique across the board and no other record can have that value. There is a default tool within Salesforce called the import wizard. This allows you to import data. That's all it does is import data. It's great for importing small amounts of leads, small amounts of custom objects. You can choose whether or not you want to have automation run. So you can say yes, run automation or don't run automation. You don't have to turn it off. You just specify whether or not you want to do that. You can also use This also allows duplication detection. So a little thing to remember when using import wizard, you want to typically use the import wizard where you have 50,000 records or less. It does allow prevention of dupes and you can choose if you want to trigger rules to fire. Data loader is the big mammoth in the room. You have access to all the objects. You can create mappings. It is an external application, does not live in Salesforce. You can use external applications to schedule the data. The user does need EP access on the user record. User needs access to the object and field, so they do need recreate, edit, and delete. User also needs bulk API hard delete. If you configure data loader to use bulk API, most of them do. So just want to make sure you grant those accesses out. Here you can see we have our options, insert, update, upsert, delete, export, or export all. We have our objects that we can select. These are the different objects that are tied to that. And then once you select an object, you can get the mapping. And then once you have the mapping there, you can also then tie it to any of the fields that are in the CSV file that you chose for uploading. Using data loader, it can load up to 5 million records. It loads objects like products or opportunities. You can schedule imports. You can save mappings for later. And it's also great if you want to do exporting or deleting data. Just a reminder, the import wizard only imports data. It does not export data or delete data. Data backup. So you have all your data in Salesforce. you do need to back up your data. There's a couple ways you can do it. You can use a report. You can use reports to run your export whenever you want. It's a manual process. You can use data loader. You can specify the data. Like as you saw before, you can save the data as a CSV or Excel. This can be manual. You can run the jobs whenever you want. You can also automate that process. You can also use the weekly data export service. This is weekly, means you can do it once every 7 days. It gives you a complete set of Salesforce data. This process can be automated, but you still have to download the data out of Salesforce. So Salesforce will run the job, create all the files for you, but you have to go into Salesforce and download all the data and store it into a repository. But backups are only one part of the problem. So once you have the backup, you need to be able to restore the data. So remember, you have a limited amount of storage for your deleted records. Once your deleted records are full, and there's no really easy way to recover lost or deleted data. If the data is lost, you need to have a way to restore it, and it's only be as applicable as your last backup. One of the recommendations for backing up and restoring your data is look for AppExchange product out there, or using Salesforce Backup and Restore, which is a product that they offer now. So you can use either one of those to back up your data. Thanks for coming, and I'll see you next time.